Now that we've gone through the behavioral interventions, let's move on to section 4 and discuss the cognitive interventions. The cognitive interventions are the role of thoughts, automatic thoughts, alternate thoughts, thought distortions, distraction, and coping thoughts or affirmations. So remember earlier we were talking about the cognitive triangle, which again illustrates the relationship between the thoughts, the behaviors, and the moods or feelings. And we discussed how you can change the behaviors through some of the behavioral interventions. The other thing you can do is you can actually change the thoughts by using some of these cognitive interventions. So let's talk about the cognitive interventions now. With the cognitive interventions, the goal is basically to focus on changing the underlying negative thoughts that perpetuate and worsen the depression. The goals of the cognitive interventions are basically to help the patient learn to identify their thoughts, to either change or cope with the thoughts, to recognize the thought patterns, and again, to help them understand the connection between the thoughts, the moods, and the behaviors. Now, before we talk about the actual interventions, I want to talk about the role of thoughts. And most people don't realize this, but the average person has over 60,000 thoughts a day. Basically, your brain is constantly chattering, chatter, 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 thinking, thinking, thinking. 90% of these thoughts are unconscious, meaning you're not even aware that you're having them. So that's something to kind of keep in mind, and it's always helpful for patients to understand that there's a lot of stuff going on that we're not even aware of. They're unconscious. Remember the other thing we talked about too when we discussed the cognitive triangle, that when patients are depressed, they tend to have negative thoughts. I want you guys to think of it like this. When someone is going through a difficult time, imagine there's like a black filter around their brain. So they're basically, reality is out here, and the way they perceive reality is they're not letting in any good information. They're only letting in bad information. All the good information is being filtered out. They're only letting in bad information. And so when someone's struggling with depression, their negative thoughts are about the past, meaning because they feel bad internally, they're trying to understand why they feel so bad. So sometimes people go to the past to try and understand why they feel bad. And when they go to the past, they're not pulling up good memories. They're pulling up bad memories. Okay, so they tend to think about their past, but to only remember bad events or situations that happened. It also affects the present, because when people are really struggling with depression, they're usually feeling really bad about themselves. They're beating themselves up. And remember, they're pulling away and isolating, so chances are they're not doing things they should be doing. And people feel guilty about this, right? They're not returning phone calls. They're not doing, maybe going to work or paying their bills or doing the responsible things that they should be doing. So they're beating themselves up for this. So they usually feel really bad about themselves. This negative thinking also affects the future, because when you're feeling so bad internally, it feels like it's never going to get better. So you start thinking in the future, this is never going to get better, it's going to get worse, you start feeling hopeless, right? And so this negative thinking really affects the past, the present, and the future in all these realms. I want to show you something called a thought diagram, and it just sort of illustrates the power of the thought. And it'll help you understand that if you change the thought, you really change everything. So the thought diagram is basically events happen, right? Things happen in life, which leads to a thought, meaning you sort of think about the event. You have a sort of perception or an opinion about the event, which leads to a feeling or a mood, which leads to an action, and that leads to a result. Okay? So I sometimes will help patients see this, and you're going to see in a couple minutes, I'm going to show you how I do this with a patient, that we use this diagram. But let me give you a very brief example. Let's say you're walking down the street, and you see a friend across the street, and you wave to the friend. That's the event. You wave to the friend, and the friend doesn't wave back to you. Okay, so the event is friend doesn't wave back. and you're thinking, oh, this friend doesn't like me anymore. Nobody likes me. So you're feeling bad, and maybe you end up kind of having a bad day as a result. Imagine if you're walking down the street, you see the friend doesn't wave to you, but you think to yourself, oh, you know what, maybe they don't have their contacts in, or maybe they're not paying attention, so they probably don't see me. What would your mood be? It would probably, or your feeling, it wouldn't probably be anything. You probably wouldn't get angry or hurt. You would probably just let it go. So do you see the power of the thought, how you can perceive an event? And essentially, when people are depressed, they're not perceiving things accurately, and they're not perceiving things positively. Okay, so that's the important thing. So when you're working with the patient, again, if you change the thought, the whole trajectory changes. The feeling changes, the action changes, and the result changes. So I'm going to show you this case example in a few minutes, but I want to point one more thing out, and that is that thoughts are not facts. Remember, the average person, 60,000 thoughts, there's this constant chatter going on, and we all tend to believe what we think. But it's very critical for patients to understand that just because you have a thought doesn't mean it's true. It just means you have a thought. One of the cognitive interventions you can use with your patient is to help them identify their automatic thoughts. Remember again that the average person is thinking constantly, but that the majority of these thoughts are under their level of consciousness. And Aaron Beck, who's the creator of cognitive therapy, basically realized this and came up with the notion of these automatic thoughts. So automatic thoughts are basically these quick automatic thoughts and judgments that we have. And they're usually negative, and they're irrational, and they're usually judgmental, and they tend to distort reality. Remember, when someone's depressed, they're not necessarily perceiving reality accurately. And it's important to keep in mind that there's always a thought, because the chatter's always there. Remember when we pulled up that thought diagram? Sometimes when I do that thought diagram with a patient, I'll ask them, what were you thinking? And a lot of times they won't know what they were thinking, but we tell them there's always a thought. So one of the cognitive interventions is, again, to help the patient identify their automatic thought. Because if you don't know you're having a thought, it's hard to know how to kind of work with it, right? So usually what I'll do with patients to help them kind of start to identify their automatic thought is to help them sort of recognize, again, with the idea that thoughts and moods and behaviors are all interconnected. If they notice that suddenly their mood drops, they can ask themselves, what was I just thinking? And a lot of times with that, they'll be able to identify the automatic thought. And sometimes if you notice that your mood's dipping and you start feeling bad, a lot of times it's because you were sort of unconsciously saying something negative about yourself or about a situation. So that's sort of helping the patient to identify the automatic thought. Once you know what the automatic thought is, right, like for in that instance with the thought diagram where the person was walking across the street and they thought, you know, oh, they don't like me, nobody likes me, they might not have been aware that that was the feeling. But let's say you worked with them and they were able to kind of realize that that was the automatic thought, then you can come up with an alternate thought. The alternate thought is basically another way of looking at the situation. So another way of looking at that situation is, the person didn't wave at me, they must not like me. Well, hold on, what's another way of looking at it? What's another possibility? And another possibility is, okay, they don't have their contacts in and they're blind, okay, right? So that's the alternate thought. So again, with patients, sometimes when you're working with them, you'll hear them say a negative thought or a thought that maybe is not quite reality, is distorted reality. You might point out that automatic negative thought and help them create an alternate thought or a counter thought. Helping patients identify thought distortions is another way that you can really help them work with their thoughts. Remember, when patients are depressed, they're not perceiving reality for what it is. It's going through that black filter. And as a result, their thoughts end up being distorted. So thought distortions are basically patterns of thought and ways in which depressed people really distort reality. And different theorists have lots of different types of thought distortions, but for our purposes, I came up with 7 thought distortion categories that I think are very relevant and applicable to depressed patients and medical settings. And here are those thought distortions. The types of thought distortions are personalizing everything. In the instance I discussed earlier, where the person thought that their friend wasn't waving at them because they didn't like them, that was an example of them taking it personally and personalizing it. Another example is believing feelings and thoughts are facts. Another thought distortion is rejecting the positive and focusing on the negative. Negative assumptions about situations. Another thought distortion is expecting perfection. Black and white thinking is another one, sort of all or nothing thinking. And the last one is catastrophizing, which is essentially when a patient feels like something's always going to end in disaster. It's never going to work out. Those are examples of thought distortions that you might see with your patients. Another intervention, cognitive intervention, that you can use with your patients is to examine the evidence for the thought. Once you've identified the thought, you can help the patient really kind of work with the thought and figure out if there's evidence to suggest that the thought is true or not. Remember, thoughts aren't facts. They're just thoughts. So you have to look at the evidence, the rational evidence, to find out whether that thought is rational or if it's irrational. So basically, you help the patient, you ask the patient, you know, what's the evidence for this thought? And is there another possible way that you could interpret this situation? Now, you guys remember Jason. He's the 43-year-old, really irritable guy who was at the diabetes clinic and kind of, you know, getting into trouble. And his targeted symptom was irritability. And so during the last 2 visits to the clinic, he'd been irritable, and I think he'd even gotten into a verbal altercation with a staff member. So what you're going to see here is this vignette really illustrates me identifying the thoughts, helping Jason to come up with alternate thoughts, doing evidence for the thought, and also discussing thought distortions with him. So, and during this vignette, I also do the sort of thought diagram. So here is Jason. So Jason, tell me a little bit more about your irritability.
Well, I get irritated over little things, you know, mostly since I've been, you know, I started feeling down. Like today, you know, I came in to get my vitals checked, and I'm sitting in the waiting room, and the nurse just passed me over. You know, it really pissed me off. There was people that came in after me, and she took them first. Like, what's wrong with me? You know, so that stuff makes me really angry. I probably shouldn't be, but I am.
No, that's frustrating.
It is.
Yeah. So what you're saying, too, is that you notice that since you've been feeling a little more down, that you're more irritable, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Well, when people are even a little bit depressed, what they notice is that they're, you know, they're more irritable because they kind of perceive things a little bit differently, and they tend to be a little more negative. Have you noticed your thoughts being a little more negative lately?
Yeah.
You have?
Yeah. Everything seems to have a negative end to it. I'll just think negatively.
Okay.
I don't like it.
And again, when people are going through a difficult time, they tend to distort reality sometimes. So I just want to show you this very interesting diagram that will kind of explain this. So events happen. Well, hold on. Let me show you this. So events, thought, feeling, action, result. Okay. So here's what happens. Events happen in life, right? Like things happen, you know, stuff happens.
Yeah.
We won't say the other word. Stuff happens in life we have no control over.
Mm-hmm.
So things happen, and then people usually, they have a thought about it, and then they have a feeling, and then they sort of react based on what they're feeling, and then there's a result.
Right.
So let me sort of show you how this worked for today. Let's use today's example. Okay, so what was the event that happened today? The nurse.
She hates me.
Well, hold on just a minute. Let's not conclude that. Okay. So wait, what happened? So the nurse didn't let you in,
she
right?
She passed me over.
So the nurse helped other patients first, right?
Yeah.
So the nurse helped other patients first. Okay, what was your thought about that? Do you remember thinking something, or did you just get mad?
Yeah, I just said that. I think she hates me, you know.
So she,
I think she has
really?
Something in for me, yeah.
Okay, so your thought was, she hates me. Okay, that's a bad feeling to feel like people hate you.
Yeah.
Okay, and what was your feeling? So she doesn't let you in, other people before you, you feel like you're telling yourself, she hates me. How do you feel emotionally about that?
Angry, you know, I mean,
angry.
Almost rage.
Yeah, sure. But you know what, I'm thinking this through a little bit, and I'm also wondering if you're a little sad too. Because if you feel like people don't like you, you know.
Well, am I not as important?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
so
no.
I guess sadness
yeah.
could be,
yeah.
you know, what's
I mean,
wrong with me?
It didn't come out
doesn't
as sadness,
help.
But like a lot of times, I just want to tell you a little bit about anger. A lot of times when people are really angry, it's their sort of go-to emotion, and that there are other emotions kind of lurking under the anger,
yeah.
like sadness or fear.
Mm-hmm.
And when you have anger, it kind of, it's a boundary. It kind of keeps people away. So so there might have been other things under the anger, especially if you think she doesn't like you. But definitely you responded with anger. And then what did you do as a result? What was your action that you took?
Well, I was pissed off the rest of the day. I mean,
But didn't you get into some sort of fight with her? 'Cause
I yelled at her.
So you yelled at her.
I probably said some things I shouldn't have said.
Okay.
But... You know,
okay.
I was angry.
Yeah, no, I hear you. And what was the result? So you yelled at her, and then what happened after that?
It just wrecked my day.
It ruined your day.
Yeah,
okay.
It bothered me.
And you know what? I bet ruined a day. I know for me in the past when I've lost my temper, sometimes I feel a little guilty afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So sometimes people feel bad when they lose their temper, you know?
Yeah.
So, okay, so this... is what happened. She was helping the other patients. Your thought is, she hates me. You got angry, you yelled at her, it ruined your day.
Yeah.
Now, I want to show you something interesting. If we change this thought, remember how I said when people go through a difficult time that it's almost like they misinterpret what reality is.
Yeah.
You know, they sort of distort reality. So what would be another way of looking at this event, that she helped someone else before you? What is another way of looking at that situation? You could think she hates
me,
or you could think what?
Oh, maybe someone was sicker than I was.
Okay.
Or needed to be there.
So the other patient needed help first, needed her more, maybe.
Yeah.
Okay, so imagine if you thought that. So she brings someone else in, you're sitting there, you know they came in after you, but you're thinking to yourself, you know what, that poor guy, he must be sicker than I am. What's your feeling then? Are you still angry?
No.
How are you feeling then?
I'm still kind of irritated that I'm not up, but I understand more, so I can, you know, I can go with that.
Okay, so you might have been a little irritated, but certainly not enraged,
no.
right? Okay.
No.
And then you might have felt like a little bit of, like, maybe even gratitude, like, poor guy, you know, at least I don't have to deal with that or whatever.
Yeah.
Who knows what? Okay, but you wouldn't have felt enraged. And what would you have done as a result? Do you think you would have yelled at her?
No.
No? Okay.
No.
So, you might not have done anything, right?
Probably not.
Okay.
You know, yeah.
Okay, so you might not have done anything, and what would the result be?
Well, the result, we wouldn't have fought, it wouldn't have ruined my day,
right.
and I wouldn't have been angry.
Okay. So, this is what's really powerful here, is how when you change the thought or how you perceive something, it changes the whole trajectory. It changes how you feel, and it changes what you do. And so I think what would be interesting for us is, I know I'm going to see you in about 10 days, the next time you're at the clinic. I think what would be really interesting is if I give you this patient workbook, and you read a little bit about thoughts, and you read a little bit about sort of how thoughts work,
mm-hmm.
explains more. And maybe do some of these exercises in here. There's like a thought diagram, a mood thought diagram, where you record some of your thoughts
mm-hmm.
and sort of your emotions, and you kind of work on that. And then I'll come back and see how you're doing with it.
Okay, that sounds good.
So, hey, Jason, how you doing? How's everything worked out for you?
It's better. It's better. I'm less irritated. Been working on my in my workshop, and I've started making a birdhouse. And
cool.
My wife's even taken notice of the change in me.
That's really cool. Are you still recording some of your thoughts and your moods?
I am. Not as much, because, you know, I find I'm not needing it as much. My wife and I even had an argument the other day, and I pulled out your diagram, and it was really helpful.
Yeah, that can be really helpful. Oh, cool. Okay, good. Well, I'm glad to see you're doing much better. You seem much less irritable. You know, I think what we'll do is just sort of, you know, keep in touch and touch base, and if you, you know, need me, then kind of let me know. But I'm glad you're doing a lot better.
All right.
The next intervention I want to discuss with you are coping thoughts or affirmations. Affirmations are basically short, positive statements that a patient can use to sort of counter a pattern of negative thoughts. A lot of times with patients, they've been having negative thoughts unconsciously and consciously for so long that that's what their brain automatically does. It's almost like a negative neural pathway has been created. To create a new neural pathway, they sort of have to tell their brain to think the opposite. And the way that affirmations can help with this is by consciously repeating a positive short statement repeatedly. After doing that for a while, the subconscious brain starts believing it. That's the whole idea with coping thoughts or affirmations. So an example of a coping thought or affirmation would be, I'm safe now, I am lovable, I'm strong enough to do this. They're short and they're simple and they're positive. So let me tell you the process of doing affirmations with your patients. The process is to sort of provide some psychoeducation about affirmations. It's also to normalize it, that a lot of times, most of us, our brains tend to sort of think these negative thoughts automatically, and it's often very helpful to sort of help create new neural pathways with the affirmations. You can also help the patient create these new sort of affirmations or coping thoughts and come up with the actual coping thoughts or affirmations. Encourage the patient to practice using them repeatedly. They can write them down on coping cards, and they can either read them aloud frequently. They can also, sometimes people like to record them and listen to them being played back. So those are sort of some options that they can use. In this next video, you're going to see me work with a woman named Michelle, who's 36 years old. She's a mother of two, and she's been hospitalized with MS. You're going to see how I help Michelle use affirmations. Michelle was seen by the hospital social worker for discharge planning, and during their interview, she repeatedly stated, I can't do this, and I feel so helpless. So the social worker is now working with her using affirmations on her targeted symptom of helplessness. So Michelle, I know that you're going through a really hard time right now, and I know that you feel really helpless. But just because you feel helpless doesn't necessarily mean you are helpless. The one thing I've learned is that thoughts and feelings aren't necessarily facts.
What do you mean by that? I mean, thoughts and feelings, I mean,
That they're not facts? Well, you know, I think we all tend to sort of believe that if you have a thought, like if you tell yourself, I'm helpless, that means you are helpless. Or if you have the sensation of feeling helpless, you therefore must be helpless. But just because you think something doesn't mean it's true. You have to kind of look at the evidence. Are you really helpless, or is that just a thought? Do you see, or a feeling that you're helpless?
I see what you're saying. It's just that feeling, it's like overwhelming, you know. It's just, I don't know, I guess it's everything. And it's just,
it's intense.
It takes over.
I know. And I know you're going through a really hard time. But I guess my concern is that I'm a little worried that if you're kind of telling yourself over and over again, I can't do this, I can't do this, I'm helpless, that I'm afraid you're going to affect the outcome. Like that pretty soon you won't be able to do anything, or that you really, you know, will be kind of frozen. Because the way you perceive and think about something affects how you feel, and it affects your behaviors and what you do. So do you have any interest in kind of working on changing some of those thoughts?
Yeah, I think I've definitely been accused of, you know, being negative.
Okay.
I would like to work on it. I just don't know how.
Okay. Well, you know what? I have an idea. And I want to preface this by saying that we're going to try something, and if it doesn't work, we'll try something else. Like, I feel like if you and I work together, I can kind of help you with this. But what I was thinking we would try is to have you do some affirmations. Have you ever heard of affirmations or coping thoughts?
Oh my God, yeah, it sounds so cheesy and new age.
I know. Affirmations. It's like on Saturday Night Live, I think they used to do a skit about affirmations.
I think so.
I mean, I could see why you would, you know, say that. But what's funny about affirmations is that they actually can work, because what happens is when you think a thought, you basically, your thoughts create sort of neural pathways. And so if you're telling yourself sort of negative thoughts over and over again, you're creating a neural pathway. So if you're kind of going off into sort of neural pathway A and you want to create a new neural pathway, one way to do it would be to tell yourself sort of the opposite. Okay. And so that was what an affirmation would do, because it starts sort of changing your conscious mind, and then it'll slowly change the unconscious until you believe it. So, I mean, that's kind of how they work. So we're basically trying to create a new neural pathway. I mean, do you want to try it out?
Yeah.
Even if it's cheesy. Okay.
I think it could help.
Yeah, I mean, it's not going to hurt you. Okay, so what if I'm going to write it down for you, and I'm also going to give you this little handbook, and I'm going to mark the part on affirmation so you can kind of read about it and about thoughts. So this one, you're basically telling yourself, I can't do this. What if you were to say to yourself over and over again, you know, I can do this. You know, I'm a strong woman. I mean, what do you think of that?
I don't know. Why? What do you think if we just change it to, instead of I can't do it, I'm a strong woman, to I can't do it because I've been through worse?
I think that's fantastic, because I've been through worse. How does that sound to you?
I don't know. To be honest, it sounds a little bit, I guess, unnatural to say it.
Well, that's good. That means we're on the right path. Because if it were natural, you wouldn't need the affirmations, you know?
Okay.
So this is something new. So just because something is new and it doesn't feel comfortable doesn't necessarily mean it's wrong. It just means that's not how you're accustomed to thinking. So what I want you to do is to take this new affirmation. I want you to read it at least like 3 to 4 times, you know, a day. And some people, what they do is they'll, you know, make little post-its and put them up in their cars and put them up in their jobs, you know, or around the house, so that they can kind of be reminded, so that, you know, the message, you are conscious of it, and then it goes to your sort of unconscious brain as well.
Okay.
So, and that kind of starts slowly changing your thoughts. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I think what I'm going to do is I'm just going to keep it with my book that I'm reading right now.
Okay.
So I can look through it, you know, during the day and, you know, keep reading it.
Okay. And the other idea I have is that some people, what they do as well is, if you have a cell phone, which I notice you have an iPhone, sometimes what people will do is they'll record themselves saying their affirmations and then listen back to themselves saying the affirmation.
Okay, I think that's a little bit too much. I think I'll just stick with the notes right now and see how that
works. Okay, that sounds good. So read through that, and then I marked this part I want you to read on affirmations in the handbook.
Okay.
And you can kind of, you know, go through there. And then what I'll do is I'll come by tomorrow and just see if you're starting to feel a little bit better. And if this doesn't work, we'll figure something else out.
Okay.
Distraction is another cognitive intervention I'd like to discuss. Distraction is basically consciously deciding to do or to think something different. And this can be very helpful for patients who are struggling with anxiety or anger or negative thoughts. It's helpful in a lot of different situations. And distraction can either be sort of cognitive, or it could also be behavioral. And here are the steps if you want to help a patient consciously decide to use distraction. The first step when you want to work with a patient for distraction is to provide psychoeducation. And you'll notice that I've been doing the same process for all of these interventions. psychoeducation for distraction would essentially be helping them understand that it's okay to distract yourself at times if you're struggling with a situation, and to normalize that there are always times that we, you know, struggle, and it's okay to distract yourself and in a conscious way. So the specific steps you'll want to take with a patient are to work with them to identify any past activities that they've used that have helped them to distract in the past, and also to assess the level of effectiveness of these past distraction techniques. You can also work with them to brainstorm other activities, maybe some cognitive forms of distraction, and also they can possibly create a coping card so that they can use it when they need to. In this next case, you're going to see how I worked with Jason using distraction. Remember Jason, that youngish, irritable man who is been struggling? He's has diabetes, and he's been struggling at the clinic. So he's worked with the social worker using a couple different cognitive interventions, and watch how the social worker works with distraction with him in this scene. So Jason, did you have a chance to read through the STI patient handbook and do some of those exercises we talked about?
Yeah, I did. You know, I notice I do a lot of negative thinking, and I tend to personalize things a lot.
Mm-hmm. Can I take a peek?
Yeah.
At some of your stuff? You did a good job going through it. It looks like, you know what I'm noticing here is that when you're watching TV, you're a little more irritable and a little more sad.
Yeah, you know, there's not a lot to watch on it. So when I do watch, my mind wanders, and, you know, then I start to think negative.
Uh-huh. So basically when you're bored, you start to have these sort of negative thoughts, and then you start feeling more sort of irritable and sad, right?
Yeah.
So it doesn't help your cause.
No.
So what could you do if you didn't want to be watching TV and bored? Is there something else you could do? Because it sounds like when you do that, it's not good for you. You know, it doesn't help.
Well, I guess I could go out to the garage. You know, I have a workshop out there, and I used to go there, but I haven't been there for a long time.
Okay. Well, what would stop you from going out and doing some of your woodworking and going out to the garage? Is there anything that would stop you from doing that instead of watching TV and being bored?
No, not really.
Okay. So I have an idea. Why don't we do this? Why don't you continue recording your thoughts and your moods and behaviors, because we got some good information from that.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to give this back to you. And then what I want you to do is to really try to go out and do some of the woodworking, especially when you notice yourself feeling a little bored. You know, why don't you try that? And then we'll kind of see how it goes. And I think you're coming back in a couple weeks, so I'll see you in a couple weeks, and we'll see how you're doing with the irritability. Does that sound good?
That sounds good.
Hey, Jason. How you doing? How's everything going?
It's going better. You know, it's a lot better. I've been doing everything that I'm supposed to do. I feel better, less irritated.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I come here, I don't know what it is, but when I come here, I still get tensed up, and I start to get irritable just sitting in that waiting room.
Yeah. So it sounds like in general you're doing better, like at home you're less irritable and you're doing better, but then for some reason when you come here, it's just a trigger for you that you just get a little more irritable. But you haven't been having any of the big sort of confrontations, have you?
With any? No, I haven't been yelling at anyone.
Okay.
I just, when I sit down and I wait there, I get tense.
Yeah, it's difficult for you. Okay. Well, I wonder, you know, sometimes when we have little triggers like that, sometimes you just need to find a way to distract yourself, because it's like it sounds like it's a very uncomfortable sensation for you to be sitting out in the waiting room and, you know, and it makes you irritable.
Mm-hmm.
So what could you do instead of sort of sitting and thinking about the fact that you're in the waiting room and you have to wait and you don't like waiting? Is there anything you could do that you could distract yourself with?
I like to play cards. You know, I don't think I can play cards out in the, you know.
Yeah,
in the
probably
make
not.
A little,
yeah.
Be a little bit more distracting.
Have a little poker area over there.
Yeah.
No, okay. So, well, what could you do instead of playing cards? Like,
well, I've got my phone. I mean, I could always download, I guess I could download a card game.
You could.
And just, that would bide my time.
Okay.
Maybe it would make the time pass and I wouldn't be so irritable.
Yeah, that's a great idea. The other thing is, too, that sometimes I think, you know, just giving yourself permission to think about something other than having to sit out in the waiting room, like, what could you think about?
I could think about, I don't know, the sermon I heard last Sunday. Mass, you know, I could remember what the pastor said, and that could bide my time. And
does that help you?
Yeah, I feel better when I think about that.
Okay. So you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to put these on a little index card for you. Because again, we kind of identified that coming to the clinic is a trigger for you. So coming to clinic, and then I'm going to put down these two options. So you basically were going to kind of download a card app or some type of game for your phone, and you're going to think about the sermon, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think I just want you to give yourself permission to kind of be distracted when you come out, because you know that waiting area, for whatever reason, we don't even need to know why, for whatever reason, it's difficult for you to be there.
Yeah.
So why don't you take these things, and then the next time you come in, like, really, you know, try to do those, you know, with a sense of, you know, volition, that you're going to make an effort to do those things. And then we'll just sort of see, you know, how you do.
Okay.
And I'm around, so you let me know how it goes, okay?
All right. That sounds great. Thank you.
Let's discuss the stop technique. The stop technique is a very simple and easy to use technique that is very helpful for patients who have negative thoughts and for patients who complain of having almost obsessive thoughts. Sometimes when you're working with a patient, they'll say they're repeating the same thing over and over and they can't help themselves. They literally can't stop. And what you can tell patients is actually you can stop the thought. You basically say stop and you think of something else. So let me explain the process for using the stop technique. Here's the process. The process is to provide psychoeducation. And that is, the first step is you want to help them understand that basically thoughts are like cognitive paths, like almost like neural paths. And that sometimes if you think a certain thought, you know that it might not end well. If it's a negative thought, and if you think the thought, you might become angry or sad. Sometimes you want to stop it so that you don't go down that negative path. And you literally say stop. And you normalize it by saying that we all have these thoughts and this is just something that happens. So the specific steps that the patient should take are basically to acknowledge the thought, because we can't stop it if we don't know what it is, right? So you need to acknowledge the thought and you literally just say stop to the thought. And then at that point, you basically do or think something else. So you either get up and change locations or you say, okay, I'm not going to think that thought. I'm going to think about something else. You make a conscious choice to change action or to change your thought. Remember Sue, who has breast cancer? She's a 55-year-old woman, and she has really been struggling with rumination. Watch how I help Sue, or attempt to help Sue, using the stop technique. Here is Sue. So Sue, tell me more about the thoughts that you're having at night.
Well, you know, I think about the cancer and then I get afraid of what's going to happen to me. And then I get really scared about my kids. What are my kids going to do?
Yeah, that's hard.
That's so upsetting. Hard.
So really, when you start thinking about the cancer, you feel
sad. I get sad and I get anxious, so anxious, and then I cannot fall asleep.
And that might be part of the reason you can't fall asleep, because when people get anxious, your body releases cortisol, which is sort of activating. So, you know, it almost revs you up. Mm-hmm. So really, do you see the connection between the thought about cancer and the feeling, which is anxiety and sadness, and then the sort of behavior, which is insomnia?
Mm-hmm.
So because your thoughts and your moods and your behaviors are all interconnected. So I wonder if we kind of helped you a little bit, maybe not think that thought at night, if that would help you get some sleep.
How?
Well, you know what? There are a couple different ways, but one thought that comes to mind is, what if when you go to bed at night and you start thinking about the cancer, if you were literally to just say stop? Like, stop. We're not going to think that thought. We're not going to go down that path. Mm-hmm. Because when you start thinking about it, you're going to start feeling sad, you're going to start feeling anxious, and you're not going to be able to go to sleep. So think of thoughts as sort of like paths, and this path doesn't end very well. So for me, I visualize like a stop sign, like stop, mm-hmm. like let's think about something else or do something else. Mm-hmm. That's the key to this technique too. Once you say stop, you can either change locations or think about something else. And that's a little hard when you're going to bed at night. But you could say stop and kind of choose to think about something else.
Stop.
Yeah. And some people, they even have like a little rubber band and they kind of flick themselves like stop.
Yeah, well, I'm not going to pop myself with a rubber band, but okay. I will say stop. I can try that.
Okay. Okay, so why don't you try that and see how it works?
Okay.
And, you know, I'll mark this off in this patient handbook and you can kind of read a little bit more about it. And, you know, I'll try to give you a call next week. And if it doesn't work, then we'll try something else. We'll help you feel better and get some sleep.
All right, that sounds good.